4 years of Natopia University and a mountain of student debt for this.
America, ladies and gentlemen. Part of me was a tad worried how these next two episodes would be able to match the pure goatness of Marcy and the Gates. Although I still think Marcy and the Gates is the best episode of the season, maybe even the whole series so far. Scavenger Hunt and the Planners Check-In were both very solid episodes in their own right. Scavenger Hunt opens with Marcy, Anne, and the Planners eating together at a Newtopian burger joint. Marcy once again showing how intelligent she is by figuring out how much the meal cost between the five of them. 28 coppers on the dot. She's also an incredibly good artist. Polly, amazed by Marcy's genius, points out they'd be set for life if Marcy landed in Wartwood instead of Anne. That comment right there was pretty much the setup for Anne's struggles throughout this episode, which is feeling inferior to Marcy due to her lack of intelligence compared to hers. After Polly makes the comment, Marcy gets a puzzle gram from King Andreas. Basically, she's got to go around to different areas of Newtopia to find hidden words for a message she sent her. Newtopia really has just been an RPG adventure for Marcy, hasn't it? More of a reason for her to not want to leave. Wink, wink, nudge, nudge. Marcy, Anne, and Sprig are the ones who partake in this puzzle, while Polly and Hop Pop stay behind. Hop Pop joins the customer loyalty program at the restaurant they ate at because the waiter told them he could get free gifts if he joins. Anne tells Sprig how she's feeling inferior to Marcy, so he suggests she should try to outsmart Marcy by solving the king's puzzle before her. I love how she got all motivated then ran right into a sign afterwards. Anne, your inner London Tipton is showing. Get it together. The first stop they make is at a coral park with the diagram showing a tree with one eye open and one eye closed. Anne suggests they should listen to the trees instead of looking at them. However, Marcy notices the statue in the park has one eye looking through a telescope with the other closed. Marcy ends up being correct because she sees the word bring spelled out amongst the trees lined up. Can I just say, I really love how even though Marcy is a genius, she is not super snobby about it. Anne's suggestion about the trees wasn't very good in my opinion, but Marcy still encouraged her idea, saying she loved it. Yeah, I just love Marcy so much, I'm sorry. As they're about to head to the next piece of the puzzle, Anne notices a little girl trying to get her quote-unquote cat out of a tree, so she saves it with no hesitation. The moment this happened while I was in the middle of watching the episode, I knew it was going to be relevant later on to help get over her insecurity about her intelligence. The next stop is at some kind of museum. Marcy couldn't figure out what the W in the picture meant, so Anne took charge. Sadly, she got stumped too and ran off with the puzzle gram to look for help. That's when she ran into an old newt named Doris. Anne asks if Doris can figure out part two of the puzzle, but she gets sidetracked with the conversation. Classic senior citizens. Doris was over here pumping out children like a bunny rabbit. Even Anne got sidetracked with Doris's combo. She began giving Doris advice about how to help her sons while also painting her nails. Meanwhile, Marcy solved the museum puzzle, figuring out the word is me. Once they arrive at the main bridge and Anne sees the giant gold statue of Marcy there, she becomes even more insecure and wanders off to cool down. This is where she befriends a nachos saleswoman named Gertie. See, they're like nachos, but with gnats instead. Gertie gives her a free sample because Anne stopped the containers for the food from getting blown away by the wind. Anne tells Gertie about her insecurity with her intelligence, so Gertie suggests to put on an act about being smart. Anne uses this advice to make up some Illuminati-esque solution to the final puzzle, eventually leading the three of them into the city sewers. Anne notices one of the wheels on a pipe looks like the circle from the clue, so she decides to turn it. Water begins to pour out of an open pipe, causing a giant gator to emerge from the pipes. Apparently, Marcy is the reason he's there, so he can eat trash in the sewers to keep them clean. But he's still a carnivore, so he wants to eat them as well. Anne can't lift up the sewer cover with just her strength, but luckily the three people she befriended came to her aid. Anne may not be as good at solving puzzles or as good at math as Marcy, but she's so good at connecting with other people, it's insane. There's something about her that can rally up total strangers to work together if it means helping Anne. I'm telling you, dude, I'm getting more One Piece vibes from situations like this. You know, Luffy has that exact same feat under his belt. He's incredible at rallying people together and having them work together to achieve a goal. Marcy even admits she's a little jealous of Anne because of how good her social skills are, whereas she has trouble looking people in the eye sometimes. When Sprig hands Anne a nacho, she notices the symbol on the nacho is the same as the one from the last clue. Sprig finishes the rest of the food, seeing the inside of the container says the Planters, with the complete message being, bring me the Planters. In the next episode, the Planters check-in starts off right where the last episode ended in a sense, with the gang about to enter King Andreas' throne room. His full name is Andreas Leviathan. I believe Leviathans are some type of mythical sea serpent from biblical times. Lady Olivia also says he's been the peacekeeper of 1,000 years. Is he really that old? I find that hard to believe. Honestly, I did not expect the king to be as easygoing as this. Of course, maybe on the friendlier side, but this guy, you know, gave the Planter family a group hug frame one after meeting them. Apparently, he's known for not really following royal protocol. Anne's hand also gave off blue sparkles after she gave the king a fist bump. Part of me wonders if he could sense her Calamity Box powers from that touch, which is why he laughed like that. Makes me wonder. Andreas tells Anne without the music box, there's not a whole lot he can do to help him get home. Anne tells him it's back in Wartwood, so she shows him a photo of it instead. Hop Pop was sweating bullets in the back after Anne told Andreas it was left behind. Those glasses he puts on to look at the picture look fabulous. You get those frames at Lens Crafters, bud? Andreas notices the gems are grayed out, and he's not sure what it means, so he suggests they'll need to translate ancient texts from their deepest archives to figure out what's going on. Which Marcy volunteers to do because she knows how to read ancient amphibia texts, apparently. Not surprising. He said the process could take a few days, so he suggests the planners enjoy sightseeing Newtopia until then. And to make sure they enjoy their stay as much as possible, he gives them a royal credit card with the unlimited funds on it. Okay, I know I said I like Andreas a lot, but I still find it a bit difficult to trust him, especially with how suspicious he was acting at the end of Marcy at the Gates. He did seem genuine with most of his reactions in this episode, though, so. If he does end up being an antagonist, I have a feeling he's going to be a, you know, chaotic neutral type antag, or maybe lawful evil. It's still hard to make a concrete guess with how little he's been shown so far. And the second half of this episode is mainly focused on Sprig abusing the power of the unlimited funds credit card. The rest of the family is knocked out tired at the hotel, so he decides to have fun on his own, and Sprig meets Bella the Bellhop during this process. She's an underappreciated hotel worker who got screwed over by capitalism. She's also voiced by Kristen Schaal, who voiced Mabel Pines in Gravity Falls. And we get a montage of Sprig's reckless spending with him buying a bunch of ice cream in the hotel, getting his hair cut to look like Super Saiyan Blue Goku, and getting so much coffee he gained super speed. Since Kristen Schaal was in this episode, I'll say this was the equivalent of when Mabel had too much smile dip. As Sprig decides to ride the Ferris wheel as his last activity of the day, he drops the royal credit card onto a chandelier. Once he fails to retrieve the card, it falls into Bella the Bellhop's hand, and she decides to steal the card from Sprig, so a chase for the card ensues. The two of them reach the card at the same time at the top of the Ferris wheel, trying to move it from each other's clutches. But look, the view from the top of the Ferris wheel that's said to change your life? Maybe money isn't so important after all. The main highlight of that episode was definitely King Andreas getting his, you know, proper debut. The second half was good comic relief, but you guys know me. I love when the plot moves forward, even if it's just a teeny bit. I think that just about does it for this episode. Both of these episodes were good. I'd give them, you know, each an 8 out of 10, give or take. I'm just wondering how many more episodes are going to take place inside of Newtopia. I'd low-key be tilted if Sasha and Grime just pulled up on Newtopia without Anne or Marcy being able to protect the city. Also, I have a feeling Marcy could go back with the planners to Wartwood for Calamity Box purposes. That wouldn't surprise me at all, considering, you know, what is shown still in the season 2 opening. But per usual, if you enjoyed the video, be sure to leave a like down below, and if you're new to the channel, subscribe, and I will see you guys next time. Peace out, take care, bye-bye.